In a working lifetime of 35 years, there have been few March days when Richard Seabrook has not seen the dawn. This is the hour at which lambs are born. These days decide the success or failure of a shepherd's year. Richard Seabrook was in need of a good one. In the 25 years that he'd been working as a freelance round farms in East Anglia, he had been building up his own flock of sheep. Half a dozen at first, now around 900. Two things marked his progress. First, he got the land he needed by winning the grazing tenancy from the National Trust here at Ickworth Park, near Bury St. Edmunds. Then, a year or two ago, he got the capital he needed from the boom in one of his sidelines, the firewood business. There was enough work to keep Richard and two partners busy for most of the year. Demand soared with the popularity of wood-burning stoves. At the same time, hundreds of blighted elms increased the supply.
Yep. 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 Yep.
At Ickworth, Richard had spent thousands of pounds on draining the land to improve the grazing. And he had embarked on the costly business of replacing the older ewes in his flock. He badly needed a good lambing season. Now, at the end of the first week, it was going well.
We lamb all our sheep out on the fields, and of course the natural thing of a sheep is to get right away from the others into a far corner or under a tree somewhere, and I'm always pleased to find them with the lambs on the feet. If the lamb is born and they're still scroggling about on the ground, then that's not just as strong as it should be. The feeding is really the crux of the matter. You can mess about with these old sheep at lambing time, take lambs in, warm them up, do what you like. If the ewe is not nourished properly, you're on a loser all the time. Some of them are nice old sorts, really, and they cooperate and they're not a bit of trouble, and some of them are old beggars. They've got no sort of mothering qualities, and you give them a marker out, and you don't breed from an old thing that won't mother its lamb. I should know them all if I didn't do anything else, if I was just like one of these dog and stick shepherds and just doodled about in that park all day, I would know everyone. That just finance won't allow me to. You've got to get about your business, and there ain't such a thing as a shepherd really nowadays with modern day sort of techniques. That the needle is taking care of no end of these chores. But the best time to get to know them is when you give them the individual attention at lambing time.
Across the road from the park, Frieda Barfoot runs an orphanage for lambs whose mothers have either died or rejected them. She's a cook in domestic service who works with Richard at the woodcutting and takes her pay in orphaned lambs.
Are you still alive? Oh, come on. Come on. Hey, stand still.
She's off a sheep that had a pair of lambs and she's rejected it, so I've brought it home to bring it up on the bottle. She should be all right in bed 2 or 3 days to let her out to run with the other sheep out here. And then, well, I suppose June, July time, we send her back down to the farm.
Not the whole bottle.
3 legs, the old girl there. She broke a leg on Richard's old green lorry. And I had her after my pet ewe had a lamb and died. So Richard said I could have her replace her because I was crying my eyes out. And then she got mauled by a pack of, well, two or three dogs, not behind her, in the park. After that, she gave birth to a pair of lambs, so I was pleased with that. And then Richard brought some Scotch blackface in the park from somebody, and they had a pair of lambs, and I had one, like, just, well, it was a little bit bigger than the palm of my hand when I brought it home, and she's got a pair of lambs on her nail.
I think she got another one there somewhere. Well, in more professional way underneath her.
Across at the park, a visitor had arrived. A man in his early 20s who first came to Richard a few years ago as a sort of disciple.
No, we weren't said born. Been in there long enough.
Richard Evans is the son of a director of a large farm company, but chose to strike out on his own. He got a job working with horses at one of the few remaining mixed farms in Suffolk. He worked in South America. He worked on a pig farm. He did a few terms at agricultural college. By then, he knew what he wanted to do, which was to follow in Richard Seabrook's footsteps as a shepherd and freelance farm worker. He asked for a job. Richard showed him where to park his caravan.
The first night, I had two blankets and there was an east wind which blows right from Bury all the way through that valley there. And I was so cold I didn't dare go to sleep. I woke up after I did go to sleep once and I was a bit frightened and I was going to die like a little weak lamb. And I didn't die. I woke up the next morning again and he left the whole lot to me. He said he'd be here at 8 and he just said carry on. And so if it was a problem, whether I knew anything about it or not, I had to get on with it. And I think that did me as much good as anything.
It was a nightmare of a lambing time, plagued by abortions, the worst Seabrook has ever had.
He still managed to keep laughing when it was possible to laugh. He'll never let anything beat him, really. If something's trying to beat him, he fights harder at it. And that's why he's now got nearly 1,000 sheep, and that's why he's going to have more, and he's going to keep going ahead.
Well, don't let the lambs go, Richie. I want to see if you've got no milk. Not a sight. Give her a mark, Rich. No teeth, as usual.
That year, Richard Evans learned something about sheep, a lot about himself, and left behind a favourable impression.
One particular night when we made a bit of hay, we were ever so keen to get it in the dry. And it was one Sunday night, and I said, oh, we'll clear it up in the morning. When I come back, he was still carting. He'd been carting it all night, and he'd got it all in the dry for him. But the first sheep we ever caught, the lamb, we held up beside my motor along the stream, and I said, look, I'll drive her along and shout to you to jump. And he jumped out of this sheep and jumped right into the stream. That was his first introduction with me the first day he came. But all a real tough sort of chap and stops at nothing as regards work, very determined.
Richard Evans got a job as a hired shepherd with the care of 2,000 sheep on the Army Range in Norfolk.
I don't come from a sheep background. My family are in sort of arable and dairy farming and more respectable sort of way of carrying on than we go on. The arable farming doesn't really suit me. I don't feel that it's right to keep spreading these fields out bigger and bigger, and there's no room for anything else. This sort of setup really suits me because you can see the sheep benefiting the land. On this old Bretland, there's a lot of rare types of plants and birds like stone curlews. which can only live here if it's grazed. They can't live anywhere where there's great long grass. There's no end of variety of wildlife here and a lot of very rare wildlife. But you've still got the army benefiting from it. You've got people making a living off it in various ways. There's people building on here, people looking after the ranges. It's a more sort of complete use of the land, and then I see some of this arable farming where you're just taken from it and your profits are coming from subsidies. I do spend a lot of days working throughout the day on my own, and over Christmas I went 2 whole days without speaking to anybody, but you only really realise how much time you spend on your own when you get in the company of other people and you start talking and you think, when was it last I had a word with somebody? A lot of people come to me and say, don't you miss the female company? Well, I say, look across there, there's 4,500 females, so there's no shortage of female company. The biggest advantages I've got at the moment are the fact that I'm single and that I haven't got a television. I think by the time one had kept me going all evening and the other had kept me going all night, I wouldn't be good for much in the morning. If I was to look forward more than a couple of years, I think perhaps I'd see things like nuclear holocaust and marriage, and that depresses me too much, so I don't bother about that a lot. Sit down. Stay there. Keep that away. Sit down. Come on, then. Come on. You're all right. Go on. That's the lamb that had the pneumonia, or so we were told. He didn't look too rough now. That's his mother. Her lamb was born dead, and that's the remains of it covering up the other one that was lost. That was a lost lamb, mismothered somehow or other. That's certainly calling to her as if it knows what's going on. She's taking it now, so we'll take half the skin off to start with and then just let her settle. Before I let it out, I'll leave it in here through the afternoon with only half the skin on, just so she knows what's underneath that skin. So if you take the skin off, she might change her mind again. And I'll probably leave them in overnight again, give her a bit of grub and water, and then let them out tomorrow morning when the others have been fed and everything's quietened down a bit.
For Richard Evans, this was to be as critical a year as it was for Richard Seabrook. After 2 years here on the range, he had renegotiated his contract so that he could be free part of the time to work as a freelance around local farms. He hoped, like Seabrook, to develop a woodcutting business. He hoped to replace his old truck and do animal haulage. Above all, he hoped by the autumn to be able to buy 100 sheep of his own. Meanwhile, back at the park, the master was taking issue with the only creature in this world he might regard as an enemy, the poor old mole.
I suppose they've been here for generations, and I don't believe in clearing everything off the face of the earth. There's a place for everything. They were sent for some reason or other, but we must keep control of them. They really take places of this park right over and make the dickens of a mess.
Well, you must dig well down, clear the run out, make a nice clear passage, and stick your trap in so this ring here just touches the ground and so that these 4 pins can move quite freely when the mole comes along and pushes his nose through the ring, and then the 2 jaws close on him. I imagine that's a fairly quick and painless sort of death for him. I hope so, anyhow.
Oh, this trap has sprung. Might have got one here. Come out here, little old beggar, you. Oh, well, he's quite really a harmless little blighter. He's got a lovely coat, really, ain't he? And really, I suppose some people, or a lot of people, have soft spots for him. I remember when I went to the shop for my first lot of strychnine, and the girl assistant in the shop was very anti-mole poison, and she thought they were dear little creatures. But of course, she ain't paying 30 or 40 pound an acre rent for grazing, so she wouldn't know the other side.
Now, at the beginning of April, lambing was at the end of its second week, and, as might be guessed from Richard's cheerful tone, was going quite well, both here at the park and at home, 13 miles away, where his youngest daughter, Susan, looks after some stock.
I'm in charge of these 20 acres, on which I keep about 50 sheep, which lamb each year. There's a few characters in there I've had for years. I wouldn't say that you get greatly attached to the whole flock. It's just impossible with a big flock. If you did that, you wouldn't want to sell any of the old cronies or anything. There's a sheep in there. My first orphan lamb I had in 1972, I think. She slipped a lamb yesterday and had pneumonia and goodness knows what, but she's pulled through all right. She's got a strong will, I think. And then there's a few old sheep that Dad didn't think were any good anymore, and I brought them home. They had their little field to themselves, and they still produce lambs. There's a black one in here, and they get quite racialist about it. If they want a gang fight, he's in the middle. It makes me feel on his side.
I did say we'd hoped to get 12 or 1300 lambs, and that would be a lamb and a half per sheep. But we've had more stillborn lambs than perhaps we normally have. The younger sheep, for some reason or other, all 20 or 30 of them have had one live lamb and one dead one for some unknown reason. We've spent all hours a daylight with them. We come before it get lights in the morning and stay till after dark in the evening. We've had various students. They have a pretty constant watch over them all day, and we lug everything in and sort of, we fight for every lamb that is born alive, even if it's only just ticking over, we take them in and bung a bit of heat on them, and we've brought a lot round. This old northwesterly airstream we seem to have been in has hit us a bit hard. Anything that's born weakly out in this, if you don't whip them up pretty smartish, then they're past the point of no return. But really, that's all me grumbling, really, that the ewes have had a nice lot of milk on them, and that's a fairly grassy sort of year. We've got a nice growing lot of lambs. I'm pleased with them, really. So all in all, I've got nothing to grumble about. Thank you.
Richard Seabrook and his friends now set out on their first sorties of the year as a shearing gang. From mid-May, it would occupy them every day of the week, and when the season ended in July, they would have sheared 20,000 sheep in flocks large and small across East Anglia.
All right, thank you. Once again, I'm here. Got a fair crop of lambs, have you?
Not bad.
Oh, you still have some ewes without lambs on,
yes, is there? Yes, there's six over there, yeah, without lambs.
Yeah,
so
and
you want to do them separately, because you don't want to put them back with the others.
I see, okay.
The others are being fed.
And you're going to have the job done over there where we generally do it.
Down where we put them, there's a fold already down there.
Okay. Right, so all right.
Which do you want to start on those first, or the...
I don't know, I think we'll get the other lot in first. Okay.
Those are very tame.
Okay.
You get them in without interest.
They don't generally seem to be very tame when we come. They seem to sense it every year, turn a little bit scattered. I don't blame them either. All right then. Down here then, Olive.
Everything under control?
Not really, no. Your meter's a bit wet, isn't it?
That will be in a minute or two, when you make a start.
Oh, ain't quite the simplest singing songs, is it?
No, it ain't, Richard.
Oh. All right, then. We'll clip them out here somewhere.
That's fair enough. Rich, all right.
Watch his idol. Mrs. Matthews on this country house keeps about 20 sheep, mainly just to keep the place tidy, really, and so she doesn't keep enough ewes to warrant keeping a ram, so I bring her a ram at the end of the season when our ewes are all mated, and then we take the wool in exchange for the service of the ram, which works out very well. It's been going on for several years now.
Shearing gangs Richard Seabrook has got together through the years have become part of the folklore of East Anglia. This year they slimmed it down to five. Richard himself and the two men who are following in his footsteps as freelance workers, Ivan Beavis and Richard Evans. Richard Seabrook's children, Susan and Paul, went along to wind up the fleeces. Years ago, he did it alone.
I was about 11 when I first started looking after sheep, and I clipped one or two with the aid of the boss the first year. So, in fact, I've been clipping now 40 years. I remember going out and clipping, 150 for a man once. I had half a crown for doing them over and above me wages. And then I used to go out clipping for a tanner a sheep, and they say, well, can't you do them for threepence and all that sort of thing. I think the longest, hardest job I ever had, I had to clip 1,000 for a man on my own, and he said I could do them providing I did them in a week. After I did them, he said, well, they look a lot better with the wool on than they do with it off, so that wasn't much of a compliment. When Ive was a lad, when he was about 16, I used to take him home at night Some nights 11 or 12 o'clock time and be after picking him up 6 o'clock the next morning, nearly dragged him out of bed, but he kept coming. And I think the worst day I ever had with him, we were clipping 300 horrible little Southdown sheep, and they needed to be clipped right down to the tip of the nose and all round the eyes and the ears, and he never spoke all day. And God, he was fed up with that blooming job. Well, my missus reckon if you're involved with sheep, you've got to be mad before you start. Said the sheep are daft and the people who look after them are even dafter. Come on, folks. Come on, brother. Ah, lovely.
There you
are. Yeah. Cool. Who was the dog? Richie Evans. Richie.
You might find out pretty strong.
Here you are, Richie. Don't want to drop it. Thanks.
Sugar.
Come on, take that off there. Lovely job. Cool.
Why do you keep so green with them? There's dirt at back sides. Did you get up against them, the sheep?
Oh,
they're so filthy. God, they're awful this year.
You've done yours in the quarter?
Some of them. No, this will shove them all through the dip hills and all.
Yeah.
So we shan't worry about them playing for the season. Oh, we always keep all them in stock, so when people start chewing us up, we say, well, we haven't done our own yet.
We got him up one night to come and do the lambs here. He fly. You remember you came over with a stirrup pump?
Yeah, a long while ago, isn't it? Yeah. About 2 years ago.